Our guest, J.J. Hergert, reminisces about Tsarist days in Russia. In that dead era, Russians threw eggs at each other for sport. Now in place of the Tsar, they have communism. Russians have stopped throwing eggs, but the yoke is still on them. Oh, boy. Of course, they don't know it, do they?
They don't know it. Well, some of them do.
What is this business about throwing eggs at each other for sport?
Well, that came in the book as a, you may say, a joke. Those were some of the old stories I used to tell from the men that came to the United States. And it was a sport by German-Russian people. The Russian people have another sport. They roll their eggs. However, there was one sport, which really wasn't a sport. When the Russian people, in my time, they had freedom enough and they had reason enough to get together on the corners of the street and sing and dance. And they have a little balalaika playing or maybe a guitar with the balalaika. And so they, of course, they would disturb the people on the corner wherever they gathered. So when the day of revenge came, that was after Easter, and there were a lot of eggs available. It's all explained in the book. It's a long story. And so when they, you want me to tell about
it? Yes, yes, yes.
Well, there.
I'm getting shell-shocked from waiting.
They would bring this particular play in play simply to get even with that fella who'd been throwing water on him every evening when they gathered there and made too much noise. So instead of throwing these, first they play up and down the street throwing eggs to one another, hard-boiled eggs, and they would catch them like our boys on the street catch the balls. Well, then when they come near this place that they want to pepper with eggs, they change the eggs and they use raw eggs or rotten eggs, and then they wouldn't be catching them anymore. They lose their skill. And the egg would pass them and hit between two windows and splatter the house. Well, that was supposed to be getting even with somebody who would throw water on them. And it was perfectly legal.
Today, a Russian omelet would be a little more serious.
It would be
involve,
a little bit more serious.
Atomic and hydrogen weapons, of course. Your book is entitled I Was Born Among the Russian Subversives, and you have four pictures on the book, which seem to be pictures of Khrushchev, Stalin, Lenin, and Marx, I suppose.
Right.
Now, that would give people the impression that you had some contact and knew these people. That's not true, is it?
It's not true. I say it right in the beginning of my introduction, that it's somewhat misleading. However, I'm giving a different identification of those fellas from speaking to Russian people who lived under them for 20 years and came over here during or after the World War II. And they told me a lot that I didn't have to read about them, who they were and what they were doing and so forth. Now, for instance, Khrushchev, where everybody says he's a Ukrainian. Well, he's not a Ukrainian no more than you are or I.
But he spent so many years in the Ukraine.
His father worked in the Ukrainian mines. Actually, it's a little bit off of Ukrainian. It's on the Don Basin.
But for many years, was he not the commissar of Ukraine himself?
Oh, yes, that's afterwards.
Wasn't he responsible for the murder of tens of thousands of Ukrainians?
Absolutely, yes. But in Russia, you were considered your place of birth. That's who you are.
There was a lot of prejudice, wasn't there?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Because your family originally came from Germany.
German people, yeah.
How many generations, though, had lived in Russia?
Seven generations.
How many?
Seven generations.
Had lived in Russia?
In Russia, right.
And yet they still thought of you as an outsider?
Right. I never became a Russian because I never took the religion. If you didn't have the Pravoslav religion, which in English is translated as right glorious religion, so their religion was supreme. Anybody else's religion was for the birds, as far as they were concerned, and they hated them.
Your opinion on this ought to be pretty interesting. There's a lady who is speaking to the press periodically, claiming to be the daughter of Rasputin.
Yes.
And she's claiming that her father was indeed an extremely kind man, not the monster that he's been painted by historians.
I incline to believe that. I incline to believe that from what I've heard. He was a drunkard, and when he was drunk, he was just sugar and spice. Where ordinarily somebody gets drunk, he gets mean. This fellow never did, from what I heard.
What about all the stories of the mad monk?
Well, we call those names. The Russian didn't call them. We call Ivan or Ivan the Stern in Russia, we call them over here the Terrible. The Russians don't call them terrible.
Wasn't he characterized as a charlatan and a sex maniac?
You mean Rasputin?
Yes.
That's probably so, but none of the Russians would tell me
that. You mean he was a nice sex maniac?
That's right.
What is that, a nice sex maniac? How can a man be a nice sex maniac?
Well,
even you've got to laugh at that one.
Those are, of course, the opinions. That's about the only way somebody can. The reason I put in the word nice was he didn't get mad. As I say, I've seen drunks. When they get drunk, why, then they go berserk. They do something bad or something mean to people. He didn't, from what the Russians tell me. He was just a nice old Jew.
In the stories we hear, the nobles drove a stake through his heart the way they would a guy like Dracula.
That is correct, because...
He couldn't have been too well loved.
They were afraid of him. He had Tsarina Alexandra Fyodorovna hypnotized, let's put it this way, to see it his way. And when she became a Russian, a Pravoslav, she really took this religion to heart, because the Russian have... and had also prophets, and their prophecies came true. I have them in my book here. So she naturally took all these prophets, and Rasputin was a prophet if you read his stories and what happened. So she took that to heart, and she believed him more than any advisors the Tsar had in his retinue there.
But how could she stand him? Most people claim that he never took a bath.
Well, that I wasn't aware, because I haven't seen him.
Well, that's part of the legend of Rasputin.
That's part.
And a lot of people blame him for being the cause of the revolution, too.
That's right.
Was he the cause of the revolution?
I wouldn't say so. I would even go as far as say, if he hadn't been killed and his advice had been followed, there might never had been a revolution, because he warned. Now, this is in the English book I read. He warned the Tsar family and others that he's going to get killed if they don't protect him. Well, he evidently didn't protect him. He got killed. He got killed by a relative of the Tsar.
Whatever happened to the religion, Pravoslavia?
Well, naturally, when Lenin got into the seat or on the saddle, it just disappeared. However, there is a beginning in my book. Right after the Bill of Rights, what we call the Bill of Rights Manifesto of October 30th, 1905, the Russian, this is in my time, I'm a witness to that. Russia in its 6 months lost more dropouts or drop-offs from their religion than it ever had been in the 900 years previously.
Which must mean, probably, that they didn't really pay too much attention to it in the first place.
That's correct.
You were born in 1892.
92.
But you lived under a Tsarist regime until you left Russia at the age of 20.
At the age of 20, almost 21.
What was it like living under the Tsar? Did you ever see him?
I have seen his... Well, picture, let's say. When Tsar would come around, he came through Armavir once, but it's so far away, and I was still a kid. I couldn't form any picture.
We'll be back to the author of I Was Born Among the Russian Subversives, J.J. Hergert, following these words. Mr. Hergert, I understand that there was a great deal of anti-Semitism and anti-Catholicism that raged through Russia during the time that you lived there.
Correct. Not only those two you mentioned, but also against Mohammedans and Protestants. However, the Lutherans, who were brought in by Catherine, they were always giving a better, let's say, recognition as being a Russian, because they were brought in as teachers and they stayed that way. Wherever there was anything... where a director was needed, he was invariably a German or a Polak.
What is it about the Russian psychology that makes them enjoy sadness?
Makes them enjoy what?
Sadness.
Sadness.
Yes.
Well, The Russian people, the mass of the Russian people, they never had anything to be so gay about it or so happy about it. They were gradually, for 900 years, or for let's say 700 years, indoctrinated to a state where they were considered nothing else but animals, and they felt like animals. However, it wasn't that way all through Russia. On the outskirts of Russia, people had more freedom and more recognition because they were better off financially, let's say. And people, again, who were body slaves, or let's say, what do you call that?
Bonded servants.
Working for people.
Yeah,
you know.
Bonded servants.
Yeah, in their house, they were just like the Negro, from what I read here.
In other words, when you lived in Russia, it was possible to own another human being.
That's right.
How much did it cost?
No, not in my time. No, excuse me.
No?
Not in money, a sense of money. But they, you see, when I lived in Russia, in 1861, the Russians were freed from slavery. 40 million of them, but no one had received any land or any other means of existence, so they had to go right back and work for those same slave owners.
And sell themselves into another kind of slavery.
You might say that. Mm-hmm. They were working on shares.
Did you have any in your household?
No, we were always free. German-Russian people never were, never became slaves.
No, I don't mean that. Did you use any in your household?
Only my father.
Only your father? What do you mean?
Well, he was a contractor, so they would work for him.
Your father used slaves?
No, they were. I wouldn't call them slaves.
You're the son of a slave owner.
They were not slaves anymore.
Well, they were sold into bondage, and if they sold themselves for 7 years and ran away, they could be put in jail for that, like any other slave, right?
That's to the landowners.
Right.
But the ones that came to the city, they were freed from bondage.
Well, that's not according to some of the books I've read
about people
coming to the city. I recall reading a book, for example, where a young woman came to the city of Moscow and sold herself into a situation where she was working as an indentured person for somebody.
She ran away.
I can't remember the year, but she ran away and was captured.
It is possible that a lot of things in Russia were possible because there were several laws. In the first place, there was one law for the nobility, one law for the rich people, and one law for the real poor people.
Were you a Muscovite?
No, I was born in Caucasia.
Now, where is that?
Well, that will come below Don River.
What kind of a Russian would you have been there? Would you have been called a Caucasian Russian?
Well, you might say by birth, yes. Mm-hmm. But actually, I explain that in the book. Actually, you belong to a state, to a certain state. Now, my people, when they came to Russia in 1763, they were settled on Volga River and in a colony that was called Denhof in German. In Russia, it was Gololobovka. So all our papers in the seventh generation, they had to go through there. You get your passport from there. Your child was born. His certificate of birth goes over there, and it's registered up there, like we do here in the county. Courthouse.
Were you considered to be a czarist, a royalist?
I considered myself, yes.
Did you think the czar was fair to the people?
I think so, as far as he was allowed to be.
Allowed to be?
Right.
We'll examine that following these words. Stand by. What do you mean as far as the czar was allowed to be, Mr. Hergert?
In Russia, the government of Russia was conducted no different than any government all through the world, including the United States. Here, when a president is elected, he brings in his advisors for whatever reason, but they're in there, and he willy-nilly has to take their advice. In Russia, the Tsar, the minute he becomes old enough to take over the throne that was left open by his father, he immediately had a group of relatives, uncles, and what have you, cousins, and a good many citizens of Russia who invariably were either hereditary, dvoryanini is the Russian word, nobility, or what do you call that when you
say... The royal court. I know what you mean.
Yeah, the royal court.
I find it hard to believe that a czar or an emperor would be ruled by his own court.
That
generally, it was the other way around.
That is correct. Peter the Great was not ruled, neither was Ivan the Grozny, the Terrible. They were not ruled. They cut their heads off, whoever didn't listen to them. But all the rest of them, if they weren't ruled, they were either killed off. And you will read that in my book, all the ones that were killed, one way or the other, mostly by poison. The Pavel was the last one that was choked to death, strangled. And then one of his sons, we know definitely he took poison, but for what reason, nobody says so. So you see, they were under pressure too. And we could read that in English stories about the war, how the Tsar would take over the command of the army and then relinquish it again and so forth. So you could see there that he didn't have the strength to come right out and defy everybody. So he gave in, and especially he gave in to his wife more than anything else.
Speaking of wives, were you married over there or here?
I was married there to a genuine Russian girl. What I mean by genuine Russian girl, she was a Pravoslavna.
Ah.
And when both of us being underage, we had to sign a paper that the children born would all have to be baptized in the Russian church and in that religion, and raised until they were 21.
Did you bring her with you when you came
right.
over?
Right. Well, I'll come to that in a second. So when she lost her baby, that was one of the best reasons for me to leave Russia. However, there were many other reasons. So...
What do you mean, she lost a baby and that was one of the best reasons for you
to leave Russia? For us to leave Russia.
Oh, for us.
Yeah.
You took her with you.
Yes. Well, I came first, and then 5 months later, she came with my parents. My parents came
right.
over here, too.
At that time in history, there was no difficulty in leaving Russia.
Not at all.
And did that marriage last?
Oh, yes. Last for 11 years until she became a good solid citizen, then she left me.
Well, what do you mean by that?
Well... that's rather personal. Maybe I didn't treat her right, but anyway.
You mean you were a brute?
Probably. She up and left me with all the children.
How many?
Three. Well, she had a baby. We had four children. We had really five. One died. She took the baby with her, and since then she was just to show you what happened. She was married 3-4 times afterwards. So. I guess I wasn't the only brute.
Probably testing out her new citizenship.
Probably.
How about you? Did you remarry?
I remarried, yes. I remarried 4 years later. I'm married to an American girl who was born in South Dakota and a Brown University graduate. And so that's how I got so, let's say, proficient in English.
Did that marriage endure?
Oh, yes. We celebrated our 40th anniversary on... July 23rd on our trip, while we were placing books.
You think it may be permanent?
I think so.
Well, I hope so. You must be about 76 now.
75.
75.
Plus.
Well, I didn't do my arithmetic too well.
Back
in those days,
enough.
When you were married for the first time,
right.
It was customary for a matchmaker to arrange
right.
the marriage.
Right.
Did you have a matchmaker?
I didn't need one. I was my own. However, the matchmaking... was not only among the poor people, but it was even conducted among wealthy people and nobility. It was quite common. Gogol wrote a whole play showing how that was done among nobility.
I've often wondered, going back, you fellows didn't have things as good as we do today. For example, you might propose to a woman and marry her without ever having seen what kind of legs she had.
That is correct.
I imagine there were several disappointments along the way.
Could be, yes. However, when I got married, they had the French modes. They followed the French custom.
Long dresses.
Long dresses, but not too long. They came up about 7-8 inches above.
You know, you've
got
a pretty good memory, because I notice as you talk about the dresses, you're beginning to smirk a little bit.
Yeah.
We'll be back to author J.J. Hergert following these words. Mr. Hergert, how would this work? Would the matchmaker be told by the gentleman that there was a girl that he saw that he thought he could really be happy with, and then would he go around and tell her about it, or what?
That is correct. However, they didn't get to see each other until the deal is consummated.
In other words, he would make the deal to arrange to marry her before he even knew whether or not she had bad
that
breath.
That is correct. Huh. He has to know how much dowry she will bring, and she'll have to know something, whatever she wants to know. But when everything is ready for inspection, then
inspection?
They brought...
Right. What do you mean, inspection?
To see each other. Now, the reason I brought this in was Gogol. Gogol wrote, when this matchmaking that he wrote about it was ready to be seen, she wanted to see her prospects, so he brought, I'm pretty sure there were five he brought together. The only thing they were not told that they were to meet all five together with her. So when she saw those and the questions were fired, why, she got rattled and ran out of the house and hollered, "Get out, get out, get out." That was the end of the play.
Matchmaker, matchmaker, make me a match. What kind of a dowry did your first wife bring you?
None. She was...
Cheated you from the beginning, eh?
She had just lost her father. She was not a hereditary nobility, but the other one. When they give a...
You mean a pretender?
No, when they give out a doctorate to somebody.
You mean an honorary?
An honorary, yes. Gosh. An honorary... They were hereditary and honorary nobilities in Russia.
Honorary but not honorable.
That's right. They were... Their title died with them. And the children didn't get use of it either.
What was she, a countess or...
He was in government position. Mm-hmm. And then, that was 2 years before I met her. And then just a few weeks before we married, her mother died. And I found out that everything they had was in hock, you might say, and so that she didn't have anything.
Did you want to back out?
Oh, no.
Were you by those standards in those days, was your family wealthy?
Fairly well, yes.
Uh-huh. Well, I'd say from that glint in your eye and that expensive suit you're wearing, you held on to the money all these years. Our guest has been J.J. Hergert, who wrote the book, I Was Born Among the Russian Subversives. This is Joe Pyne. Thank you for listening, and straight ahead.